And since it's impossible to escape it, you got to learn how to deal with it. Because not being offended is unachievable. It's not doable. There are no exemptions from it. It's going to happen to you. It's interesting that in New Zealand, only a certain amount of the birds can fly. 41% of the birds in New Zealand are flightless. The kiwi, the penguin, and on, they cannot fly. And here's the reason why. There are no predators on the island of New Zealand. They do not have snakes. They do not have wolves. They do not have bobcats. They don't have anything that would eat the birds. Therefore, if there are no predators, there's no need to fly. And when there's no need to fly, you lose, eventually, the ability to fly. If you go to New Zealand, and I've gone many times and preached, you'll see birds walking around everywhere, and they don't have wings, they have little knobs. They've lost their wings through the generations because nothing ever opposed them. Nothing ever came against them. Nothing ever was a predator in their life. So it's a predator that creates the ability to fly. If you want to scratch around in the barnyard for the rest of your life, then just don't have any enemies and just don't have any problems and just don't go through any offense. But if you want to soar like an eagle, you can, but it's going to require some opposition. In other words, airplanes take off going into the wind. If you talk to any pilot will tell you when they're taking off in an airplane, they want to know which direction the wind is blowing so that they can go into the wind, because it's the wind that gives the airplane something called the lift. Without the wind opposing the wings of that plane, it won't get lift. And it's so important that we understand that 41% of the birds in New Zealand cannot fly because they have never had opposition. They've never had a predator. They've never had a problem. And you'll never mount up with wings as eagles until you go through attack and you go through persecution and you go through being offended. Opposition enables you to do things you could not do had you not had opposition coming against you. It's what gives you lift. It'll make you lift your prayer life. It'll make you lift. You'll run to God. You'll mount up with wings as eagles and fly to God. And if you'd have stayed, if you don't have the opposition, you'll stay right where you are. God intends for the winds of contrary opposition to take you higher. They'll make you fly to God. Now, what was taking place in this story in the Old Testament in 2 Samuel 10 is this. David was king of Israel. And he heard one of his old friends, King Nahash, had died. And he thought to himself, he's been kind to me. He was always kind to me. He was a good man. So I want to show some honor and be kind back to him. And I know his son is taking the throne. So as a gesture, like we would do here in America, if we heard a president in some other nation had died, we out of respect would president himself would go, or he'd send his vice president, or he'd send some high official to show condolences and to show and hopefully give some comfort and share and say, we care enough to send representatives on behalf of America to grieve with your nation. Well, this is what David was trying to do. He was trying to show kindness. So he sent two of his mightiest men in his army to go to this foreign country, the children of Ammon, the Ammonites, their king had died, and his son was taking the throne. And when they got there, someone had gotten into the king, the young prince's ear, and said, do you really think that they're coming to show comfort to us, to show respect and honor to us? They're not coming for that. They're coming to kill. They're coming to spy out the land. They're measuring the walls. They're trying to figure out. They're here spying this place out. They're getting intel that they're going to take back, and they're noticing where our weaknesses are, and they're going to invade our city and take our city. And so the Bible said, after they were falsely accused, because they were falsely accused, and they were not there for that reason. They had no intentions. They were there to show kindness from their king. Now, this is important. and somebody is about to offend them. You can be in the perfect will of God and do everything right, and you still can't escape being offended. They falsely accused them, and the Bible said that this prince ordered that their half of their beard be shaved off. I'll explain how of a humiliating thing that was. And then that their skirt or their robe be cut off all the way in the back up to their buttocks to expose their rear ends. How humiliating. Half their beard cut off. I think it's funny whether you do or not. And they, do you want me to illustrate? And they cut off and they're showing their, it's like spank babies. I mean, these mighty men, for the mighty men, it probably would have been better had they beat them up or stabbed them or wounded them or cut them. But to go home like this, to go home totally humiliated, half of your beard is gone. And on top of that, your rear end is showing. And you spank baby, go home, and they're humiliated. And it's you talk about being offended. It wasn't a physical thing that was so bad. It was the emotional fact that they had been humiliated and offended. I'm not sure they would have got a lot of sympathy from other Bible characters. I doubt Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego would have been very sympathetic. We got thrown into the fiery furnace, and all that happened to you is you got a little trim to your beard and you're showing a little underwear. That's not persecution. You ought to go through what we went through. And maybe Daniel would have said, my goodness, that's nothing compared to what my enemies did to me. They threw me in the lion's den. But they're going through it mentally, emotionally. The Bible said that they leave that place humiliated, the cutting off of the beard in Middle Eastern thinking, still to this day, was distinction and honor and maturity. Like in the Middle East, they were tampering. When he shaved half the beard off of these men, they were tampering with their rank, with their identity, with their pride. They sent them home like children, humiliated, who they were. A token of their authority had been cut off, and now had cut off, and now they're showing their back parts are exposed. How humiliating! And it all happened doing the king's business, doing exactly what they were told to do. If you live for God and you seek to do His will, you will find yourself wounded doing God's perfect will. No one is exempt from it. If you get in a church like this, you will get wounded. Isn't that beautiful? Wow. Sing in the choir, you will get wounded. Usher, you will get wounded. Park cars, somebody's going to flip you a bird. You will get wounded. It's doing the will of God. It's somebody's going to roll their eyes. Somebody's going to talk about you. Welcome to life. I love this story because the Bible said as they were approaching coming back home, these mighty men, again, these were not weak men. These were not just little wimpy guys. They didn't even go prepared to fight. They probably would have fought, but they didn't even have their weapons with them. They were going on a peace journey, a comfort journey. And now they're coming home humiliated. They're looking at each other and about to come home to their hometown. And David hears what happened, and he sends a man out and says, don't let them come into the town. I don't want them in the town circle to be humiliated, and the other people and the other mighty men to see them. Tell them instead to go to Jericho. Now listen to this. Jericho means sweet fragrance. I want them to go over there to that sweet place, and I want them to stay there and lodge there until their beard grows back, and we'll get a seamstress down there, and we'll get their rear ends covered up, and everything's going to be fine. But I need them just to go to Jericho, the sweet place. Go to Jericho. Listen to the instructions. When you get offended, here it is. I love the fact that he didn't let them come in and everybody see them in their shame. It reminds me of the prodigal son story when the father heard his prodigal son was coming home covered in the slop of the pig pen, he ran out with the robe, with the shoes, covered him, didn't want all those people to see him in his condition. I'm thankful we got that kind of king who doesn't want to humiliate us and doesn't want people to see our shame. Just go to Jericho. When somebody offends you, listen now, just go to Jericho and stay sweet. Your beard will grow back. Your beard, your respect will come back. Your honor will come back. Your authority is coming. I know what they did was bad, but calm down, calm down. It'll all come back. It'll grow back. Don't get mad. Don't get angry. Don't seek vengeance. If you'll just stay sweet, everything's going to get better. It's going to work for your good. Just keep the right spirits. Go to Jericho, the sweet place, and stay sweet. Stay at Jericho till your beard comes back. I promise you, everything's going to be all right. It's so hard to stay sweet when we get offended. The natural person just wants to get in a shouting match, get in a fight. You cut my rear end and exposed it. I'm going to do something even worse to you. Here I go. And we want to go after and retaliate. The king said, you go to Jericho. You stay sweet till your beard grows back. I think of Romans 14 right here. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, neither give place to wrath, for vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord.
In fact, practical atheism. Worry is, in fact, practical atheism. You really don't believe God can come through in this moment to protect you, to provide for you, to heal your body, to deliver you, how to set you free from the addictions that are destroying you, how to break the chains of misery and habit that have enslaved you or the members of your family. From the Word of God today, I'm going to prove that God is absolutely in control of planet Earth. And He can be absolutely in control of your life if you'll let Him. He will not demand to override your free will. But if you will give Him the opportunity, He will make a way where there seems to be no way. And He will scatter your enemies like the shucks of the summer threshing floor. Because our God is an awesome God. He is almighty. He is all-knowing. This sermon is a penicillin shot for worry addicts. Roll up your sleeve. The great physician is in the house. Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Ready? Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. With thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Jesus Christ. Read the first four words. Be anxious for nothing. An all-powerful God flung the glittering stars against the velvet of the night. Why? They were to become celestial evangelists to every nation on the earth. That there is a greatness and grandeur that they do not understand. That is the majestic hand of God. An all-knowing, all-powerful, omnipotent God calls the stars by name. We can't even locate them with the massive telescopes we have. But God calls them by name. He holds the seven seas in the palm of His hand. He measures space with His fingertips. He weighs the mountains in the scale and the hills in the balance. The God that we serve has total control. He said, let there be light. And in that moment of time, darkness was shattered and conquered forever. His Son, Jesus Christ, walked upon the raging sea of the Sea of Galilee, and He held the winds in His fist, and says, peace be still. That's control. That God is in control of planet Earth. Not the United Nations, not the European Union, not the tyrants and the dictators in New York, not the power-hungry politicians in Washington, not the fake news frauds that are tearing up this country, but our Father which art in heaven, he is in charge of this nation. God is in charge of your life if you let him. Hear again that God made you a free moral agent. And you have the right not to believe in him. But he also has the right to judge you for not believing in him. Don't ever believe that you're going to thumb your nose at God and get away with it. That is a stupid theology being put out in the universities of America. He's not a doting grandfather sitting benignly in the heavens. He is an almighty, all-powerful God that created heaven and earth. This is my Father's world. Is your life in a state of chaos and confusion? Are you stressed and depressed? Is your life constantly difficult with unending disappointments? Have you given up hope and embraced anger? Anxiety. Hear the words of the text. Be anxious for nothing. Say that with me. Be anxious for nothing. Now we go to Matthew 6, where Jesus is giving a stress seminar. Five times in this text, he says, take no thought. Be not anxious. Don't worry. In verse 25, it says, don't worry about life. It's the Greek word psyche, which means the temporal physical life. And it has the implication of stop worry. Verse 27, which one of you can add one cubit to his body by worrying? A cubit is 18 inches. Verse 28, why do you worry? Verse 31, do not worry about food and drink. 34, do not worry about tomorrow. The Greek word there is don't start worrying. So you have two Greek words here that say stop worrying, and if you are worrying, stop it, and if you stop worrying, don't start worrying again. Why? Because God is your Father. He is your provider. He is Jehovah Shammah. He is the Lord who is there. He is the Lord your healer. He is the Lord your defender. He is your rock. He is your fortress. He is your high tower. He's the one who calls and says, I will answer in the time of need. His angels go before you to make a way for you. They are your He guides and he provides. He leads in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because the God of heaven is with me. Have you ever noticed how worry comes in a bad time? It comes at a time of crisis, just when you need a clear mind and steady nerves to make a great decision. Here comes worry. Like a dark cloud to hide the sun. Like a leech draining creative ability to think. Worry is a killer. It makes cowards out of strong and aggressive men. It fills the face with wrinkles and apprehensions. Are you listening? Wrinkles and apprehensions. You're smearing goo on your face that costs $50 an ounce, hoping it'll remove a wrinkle. The best thing you can do for your face is quit worrying. Worry paralyzes the man so that it can't produce a better idea to solve a new problem. It robs your body of rest at night. It sends you to work shattered, shaky, second rate. You are on the naked edge. Again, medical science, not theologians. Medical science proclaim that worry is the mother of cancer. Worry is the source of heart disease. Worry is the thing that causes high blood pressure and ulcers. It's not what you're eating, it's what's eating you that matters. Worry proves that you don't believe God can take care of you. Worry is faith in fear. Worry is faith in fear. The two words in the New Testament from the mouth of the apostles, fear not, fear not, fear not. not the past. Why? Because your past has been forgiven and forgotten. Fear not the present. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Joshua 1:9. Be not afraid, for thy God is with you wherever you go. David said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Remember that death is now just a shadow. The shadow of the lion cannot bite you. The shadow of a serpent cannot hurt you. The shadow of a sword cannot cut you. Death has been reduced to a shadow. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Psalms 27:1. Hebrews 13:6. The Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man can do with me. Fear not death. The Bible says, I am he who was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Fear not sickness, because this is the book of the great physician. Fear not poverty, for it is the Lord that gives you the power to get wealth. Fear not other people. The Bible says, I will make your enemies to be at peace with you. God can be the best public relations firm you ever hired. I will drown Pharaoh at your feet. You will climb the impossible mountain. I'll give you the ability to defeat the impossible foe. 1,000 shall fall at your left hand. 10,000 shall fall at your right hand. David said, I will fear no evil. Why? Because God Almighty is with me. That's why.
Give thanks in every situation. Give thanks in every situation. For every great why, there's a great how. For every great why, there's a great how. You worship born of your experience. Tribulation, the Bible says, worketh patience. And patience, experience. And experience, hope. And that hope does not make us ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. The only way to properly worship, the only way to truly worship, is out of what you've been through. You can tell somebody else's testimony, but it's not your testimony. You can preach somebody else's sermon, but it's not your sermon. Come on, help me if you can. You can pretend to carry on like you see somebody else carrying on Sunday morning, but if it's not born out of your experience, it's false and fake, phony and untrue. But when God has been real good to you, when God has really brought you out, your worship takes a kind of different kind of flavor, a different kind of turn. Because it's no longer just repetition. It's no longer routine. It's no longer just showing up. Now that you know why, you get excited about how. I know why I worship. But Paul teaches us how to worship. He says, rejoice evermore. Always be rejoicing.